Financial Survival Network, helping you to survive and thrive in the new economy.
This is the Financial Survival Network.
Financial Survival Network is presented to you by Regal Assets. Buy and sell physical gold and silver through your existing retirement plan 100% tax-free with Regal Assets. If you want to include physical gold or silver in your existing IRA or old 401k, request your free investment kit, which was recently featured in the Forbes and Smart Money Wall Street Journal magazines. Call toll-free 855-678-6620, 855-678-6620, or visit regalassets.com. Where is the world economy heading, and how will it affect you and your community, your savings, if you have any, or your relatives, your country? Well, Peter Schiff has been sounding the alarm for nearly a decade now, and everything he's predicted has come to pass. And while the timetable remains a bit murky, the outcome really isn't in doubt. So if you want to know where you're heading, listen up. Hey, Peter, welcome back to the Financial Survival Network.
Thanks for having me on, Terry. And your Freudian slip of death is actually pretty appropriate.
Yeah, I think so. And, you know, we haven't talked since, I guess it was January in the Bahamas at Freedom Fest. How is everybody? How are you doing?
We're doing okay. And obviously, you said we're going to be headed to the sunny climate of Las Vegas in mid-July for the next round of Freedom Fest. So we'll see you there.
Yeah, there's nothing quite like Vegas in July. If you haven't done it, July 11th through July 15th, last year I think there were about 2,500 freedom-minded people. This year, who knows how many, but more people are definitely waking up. You've got a new book out there that I've been reading called The Real Crash. Just came out in late May. Basically, what you're saying, what we experienced in 08 and 09 was just a warm-up, huh?
Basically, I mean, when I wrote about those events in my 07 book, Crash Proof, I did see all this coming as far as the bursting of the housing bubble, the ensuing financial crisis, the Great Recession. I did get all that, but that wasn't the economic collapse that I was trying to encourage people to prepare for. I thought those were the events that would usher in, that would set in motion that collapse, because I was confident the government would make all the mistakes that it made to create that problem. It would come to the rescue with bailouts and stimulus, and the Fed would be in there and government would be in there doing all the wrong things, and that massive stimulus was ultimately going to be the drug that killed us, because we get an overdose of the stimulus. And that I believed that the real crisis was not from this disease that I had diagnosed, but it was going to come by way of government's cure. Unfortunately, they've given us that same, quack cure that I knew that they would. And I think that the real crash is coming, and it is going to be so much worse for the average American than what we endured in 2008, specifically because of all the things that the government has done to exacerbate the problem and delay the day of the reckoning.
Yeah, so effectively what you said is the cure is far worse than the disease, and the cure makes the disease effectively metastasize. And I guess the contention is the U.S. is bankrupt. Most people in the U.S. are bankrupt. And I guess what we've seen happen in Europe, really the entire Western world is bankrupt, isn't it?
Well, a lot of governments are broke. They have promised far too much to voters in order to secure their elections. And we're having to come to terms with that. Certainly, Europe, as a whole, is not broke. But you have some countries that are, some countries that aren't. And there's a problem there, because countries that are still solvent are being asked to contribute more and more to prop up those that are not. But those that are insolvent, I don't think they have a gun to the head of the other country saying, if you don't back us out and prop us up, well, then we're just going to leave the Eurozone and it's going to be even worse for you guys. So you have that dynamic, but you have a larger dynamic going on between America and a lot of the emerging economies, particularly in Asia and specifically China, where our relationship with China is similar to Greece's relationship with Germany. And the question is, how much longer will the Chinese and other emerging market economies be willing to prop up the U.S. economy by lending us the money to buy their stuff? You know, and at some point, it's going to come to an end, and we're going to have to face the dire consequences of our prior failures, just the way potentially you have certain people in Europe having to confront the same problem.
Well, in point of fact, though, in history, looking at history, all governments eventually go bankrupt, and they drive their countries bankrupt as well. I mean, the examples are just one after the other after the other. Nothing really changes. So once the U.S. has finally defaulted on its debt, either through inflation or through just an outright default where they don't pay, how do we teach the rest of the world and our children the futility and the eventual destructive results of taking on debt to finance consumption?
Well, I know. Well, they're going to see the consequences of that firsthand. But it is amazing that everybody wants the U.S. government to help, right? We're saying the U.S. government maybe should help Europe. The U.S. government should help out the states if the states are in trouble. Well, the U.S. government is also broke. It's not like we're sitting on these huge surpluses that we can tap into. The U.S. government is borrowing trillions of dollars a year. Much of it is being financed by the Fed. So the U.S. government is not in a position to help anybody. The U.S. government is borrowing itself. All we can do is borrow some additional money on behalf of other entities that we won't help, or, you know, we could print money. But that is not going to solve problems. It's going to make them worse. I don't know. Will people make the connection when this real crash comes? Will enough people understand that it was government action and it was central banking that brought it on? Or will they again be led to believe that it's some inherent failure of capitalism, that the problem is we just didn't have enough government regulation, and the solution is to make sure that we have even more government involvement in the future to protect us from capitalism? And hopefully we don't come to that conclusion, because that simply means much more pain to come.
You know, for those of us, you have a son, I've got children, and I'm trying to educate them and explain to them how the ultimate result of debt is bankruptcy if you're not borrowing money to create wealth, if you're just borrowing money to consume. But, you know, we've got this election coming up. It seems to me that the 800-pound gorilla in the room of the de facto bankruptcy of the United States isn't being addressed by anyone other than Dr. Ron Paul, who's kind of been dealt out of the hand.
Yeah, nobody wants to look at the underlying solvency. You know, I've heard people point to Greece and talk about all their unfunded liabilities. We've got more as a percentage of our GDP. And we can't afford to repay the national debt. I mean, even if you forget about all the contingency and all budget liabilities and just look at the treasury bonds that are already out there that we've sold, we can't retire that debt. We can't pay 15 or 16 trillion to our creditors. We've got about $5 trillion, that is due in the next year. We don't have that kind of money. But obviously, the intention of the government is simply to borrow the money necessary to repay the maturing notes. Well, what if we can't do that? What if interest rates go up? Yeah, it's really easy to service this debt when interest rates are at zero. But what if they go higher? You know, even Senator DeMint was able to ask this question to Ben Bernanke, and Ben Bernanke's response to DeMint's observation, what are we going to do as a nation if interest rates go up? How are we going to service this enormous debt? And Ben Bernanke said, don't worry about it, because even if interest rates go all the way up to 1%, it's only going to add $100 billion a year to the deficit. All the way up to 1%. What if they go to 5%? What if they go to 10%? 1% is still artificially low.
It's total denial. It's just pouring gasoline onto the fire. Eventually, this thing is going to collapse. And after the dust settles, do you think we're realistically going to go back to a gold standard or sound money?
I hope so. I mean, that's the only viable solution that will work. And I think countries are going to figure that out, that you have to have money in a monetary system. And just pieces of paper, that's not money. I mean, you know, yeah, it can circulate as a money substitute for a while, but in the long run, it's not going to work because it has no intrinsic value. It won't preserve its purchasing power, and it allows governments to do all sorts of destructive things before they destroy the currency. So I think all this is coming. We need to recognize the successes that we achieved as a nation under the gold standard, and we need to go back to something that works rather than what we have now, which is a disaster.
Right. Your Pacific Capital has kind of been on a gold standard since you started talking about this, and it's prospering, right?
Yeah, we're doing all right, and I think we're going to do even better as the U.S. economy unravels along the lines I feel that it will. I mean, right now, you still have so many people seeking out the percent of safety in the U.S. dollar and the U.S. treasury market. So that works against our long-term strategy. I don't think there's any safety in these U.S. assets. I think it's a false perception. But, you know, sometimes these false perceptions, die very hard. I mean, they're with us for a long time. But eventually, it's going to end. This perception is going to give way to reality. And we're not a safe haven. We're in more debt than Europe. I mean, we're the biggest debtor in the history of the world. Clearly, we can't be a safe haven from debt when we're the biggest borrower and we have no real capacity to repay. So I think when the world wakes up, then that's going to be a time in which our strategies are going to attract a lot more attention because people will immediately see their effectiveness because the dollar is falling and you've invested in precious metals, you've invested in foreign currencies, foreign stocks, then that, you know, that shows up immediately in your accounts.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, the illusion can only carry on for so long. I mean, I had Martin Armstrong on recently and his contention was, you know, when dominoes fall, they don't always fall in a straight line predictably like you're expecting it to happen, but they're all going down at some point. And perhaps the U.S. will be the last, but when it does happen, it's going to be a scary thing for a lot of people, isn't it?
Well, wherever, look, the dominoes are going to connect up to ours at some point, whether it's last in the middle, but we're the big one. And, and we're borrowing money from everybody. We're benefiting right now from all this global uncertainty. Again, even though there's more to be worried about here, the fact is worries about the U.S. are on the back burner right now, because other concerns seem to be more paramount. But that's not always going to be the case. And when attention is really focused on our problems and the enormity of them, this is going to be huge. And, you know, remember, there are a lot of people that are holding treasuries, that are holding dollars, that are going to be looking for a way out. And, you know, it's going to be very crowded trying to get out of the dollar. And I think that's going to be, you know, it's very disruptive to the people that are still in or that are trying to get out, but they can't find a bidder.
It's a world I almost am afraid to envision. I mean, obviously, I followed a lot of your strategies and others because it's obvious to me that all government debt, eventually, all fiat currency experiments, we're living on borrowed time because they all fail. I mean, it's 40 years.
You know, that's what they're saying now. They're saying everything is okay in America. No one has to worry about default because we have a printing press and we can print money. Yeah, I mean, that's the same thing as default. In fact, it's worse. I mean, I did a TV show on MSNBC last weekend. The so-called economists that were there, they're all saying the Fed needs to do more. They need to create more inflation as if, you know, making the price of stuff go up is somehow going to create jobs and economic growth. I mean, that's what passes for economics in America. And if you want to know what passes, you know, for legislation or look at what Congress is going to do, just look at the YouTube video of my congressional testimony from last week on Thursday. I testified. I mean, these clowns in Washington are thinking about extending government mortgage guarantees to securitize pools of multifamily houses. In other words, they want to do what they did with Freddie and Fannie and single family homes. They want to do, they want to recreate the very types of toxic assets that blew everybody up. They want to do it again in multifamily. They don't even understand the cause of the last financial crisis that just happened, and they want to repeat all the mistakes. You know, I went down there to try to warn them not to do it, and I was trying to, you know, give my advice against a whole panel full of lobbyists who are, have a vested interest in these government guarantees, because they're the ones that will specifically profit from the guarantees. And you can see how Congress reacted. You can just watch it, you know, YouTube. Peter, you know, Mr. Schiff returns to Washington, and you can see, you know, the excerpts that specifically included my testimony and the interaction between the members of Congress and me.
I mean, nothing ever changes, and they're certainly not there doing the people's business. They're doing the lobbyists and the large financial institutions' business. No question.
Oh, absolutely. Yeah. And they're in the business of getting reelected.
Yeah, because if they're not in power, then where does that leave them? A lot of people of very questionable talent and ability just seem to be attracted to government, just seem to just be part of this whole mess. So obviously the Real Crash is available at Amazon. People want to find out more about you and what you're doing, Peter, where would they go?
Well, they can go to my corporate website at europac.net, EUROPAC.net. A lot of information there. I also know I do my own daily radio show, which, by the way, is going to get picked up on more stations and syndication on August 1st, because my show is going to be replacing the G. Gordon Liddy show, which, you know, the G-Man is stepping down at the end of July, so I'm just taking over his show. And so that should give me a wider audience, but people can listen to it right now wherever they live on the internet at shiftradio.com. I do the show 2 hours a day from 10 a.m. to noon Eastern time, Monday to Friday.
All right, excellent. Shiftradio.com. Get the Real Crash, because what you've seen so far, you ain't seen nothing yet. And, Peter, we will see you in Vegas in July.
Yeah, I will be there. I'll see you.
All right, you be well.
You too.